So, this morning's passage is about hearts and mouths. Listen to Paul, what Paul writes in verse 9. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. A young man and his girlfriend were making plans to get married, but they felt that it would be better if they waited until they could financially afford to do it. The young man was offered an opportunity by his company to work temporarily in a new plant in Spain for a good bit of money, more than he was making at the time. While he didn't really want to go and be apart from his girlfriend, he decided to accept the job offer because it would enable him to earn the money that he needed to marry her. They began making plans to pool their resources and put a down payment on a house when he returned from Spain. As the lonely weeks went by in Spain, however, his girlfriend began to wonder if he was being true to her. After all, she reasoned, Spain has a whole lot of beautiful, intriguing women. She wrote him and asked if he was going to be able to stay true to her with so many beautiful women all around him. He wrote back saying that he was paying absolutely no attention to the local girls. I admit, he wrote, that sometimes I'm tempted, but I fight it. So he is paying attention. I'm keeping myself for you. A short time later, the young man received a package in the mail from his girlfriend. It contained a note and a harmonica. I'm sending this to you, she wrote, so you can have something to take your mind off those girls. The young man wrote back that he was practicing playing the harmonica every night and thinking only of her. When he finally returned home to the States, his girlfriend was waiting for him at the airport. As he rushed forward to embrace her, she held up her hand and said sternly, "Hold on there. First, I want to hear you play your harmonica." He proceeded to pull out the harmonica and play a beautiful tune. His girlfriend kissed him and said, "I know now that you love me. You have proved with your mouth on the harmonica that you love me with your heart." He proved that he loved her with his heart and his mouth. Our Lord expects the very same thing from you and from me. Paul's probably not suggesting that we all learn to play the harmonica. And I doubt he's saying that we have to go away from the Lord in order to prove it. He is saying, though, that we must love the Lord with both our hearts and our minds. So this morning, let's look at how that might look. Our Father offered us salvation through Jesus. Our response is supposed to be to believe in our hearts and confess with our mouths that Jesus is our Lord. That's how we grow in our faith. There are two parts to that growth. First, we are to believe in our hearts that God raised Jesus from the dead. Some followers of Christ do follow Jesus as far as the cross, but they stop there. That's really sad because it's not the whole story. You know, every year, thousands and thousands of people climb a mountain in the Italian Alps, passing the stations of the cross along the way in order to stand at an outdoor crucifix. One tourist noticed a little trail that led beyond the cross. He fought through the rough thicket and, to his surprise, came upon another shrine, a shrine that symbolized the empty tomb. The shrine that symbolized the empty tomb, however, had been neglected by almost all the tourists who had climbed the mountain. Brush had grown up all around it, and most people had gone as far up the trail. Most people had gone as far up the trail as the cross, but there they stopped. That's pretty much the same as only following Jesus as far as the cross. The truth of the matter is that there's no salvation in believing that once upon a time, there lived a good man named Jesus who taught many, many good things and then died on a cross. Paul writes, "Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead." When we add the affirmation that God raised Jesus from the dead, we're adding a whole new dimension to our faith. Millions of good men and women have lived and died, and some even died on the cross. But only one rose from the dead, and only one still lives triumphantly, and only one is still available to his followers today. It's faith in the resurrected Jesus that saves us. It's our faith in the risen Christ that you and I need to continually nurture and nourish. Some Christians have confessed faith in Christ, and still, even though they're members of a church, they experience an emptiness in their lives, and they feel very little joy in their faith. By the same token, then, they do very little toward growing in their faith and serving God or serving others sometimes. Sometimes they attend a service only when it fits into their schedule or when they feel like it. In reality, though, if we're not growing in our faith, we're still not as strong in our faith as we should be or can be. We often fall down when it comes to the part about serving God and serving others. I know a woman who experienced those feelings for quite some time. Actually, I know a lot of them. For quite some time after she invited Christ into her heart, she still felt empty. There was something missing in her life, and she just couldn't put her finger on what. And truthfully, she always thought that once someone became a Christian, that they would be filled with instant happiness and an instant sense of fulfillment. And that was that. She thought she would feel different than she felt, and she never expected to feel the emptiness that she was still feeling. She even began questioning the validity of her faith. One day, while reading the Bible, she realized something she hadn't really noticed before. And that's what happens when we read the Bible, but we keep noticing different things in the same line, even if we read it 50 times. She was struck with the realization that she was forgiven and clean. She was part of that everybody that the Lord had forgiven. But still, she felt an emptiness in her life. And she realized that she needed something more than simply accepting Christ as her Lord and Savior. Finally, she realized that to truly believe in her heart, she needed to be fed spiritually. So in that case, she began to set time aside every day to read her Bible and to pray. She began to make time every week for Bible study and worship and fellowship with her church body. She began actively seeking ways to serve God and others in the process. Over time, key word, she made time for Bible reading, prayer, study, fellowship, service, and worship. And her feelings of emptiness disappeared. For this lady and for others too, the Bible is sometimes, I think, an undiscovered treasure. Like finding the empty tomb at the top of the mountain and realizing that there's so much more to the story. But believing with your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead is only half of what growing in your relationship with Christ is about. It's a part of growing in Christ. Paul also writes, if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. So to grow in our faith, we also need part two, to confess with our mouth that Jesus is our Lord. Christ must be in our heart and on our lips. A lot of Christians say that they have Christ in their hearts, but they don't have Christ on their lips. Some feel that they would be ostracized from their friends, or that their friends will avoid them if they talk too much about Christ. And let's face it, there are folks who would rather spend an hour with an insurance salesman doing his hardest job on the top of his game than with a Christian excited about their faith. Some people feel they don't want to be a nuisance, so they try to be silent, the silent witness approach, right? Instead of having Christ on their lips. Now, don't get me wrong, there's something to be said for silent gestures of Christian love and service. Remember that Jesus warned us about making a show of our religion. Still, when a friend is floundering in darkness and needs someone to say something positive, something reassuring, something life-giving, then remaining silent may not be the best thing to do. There are times when we need to put in a good word for Christ. doesn't have to be an eloquent statement. It just needs to be a statement about simple faith, an affirmation that Christ is alive and that Christ is available to everybody who calls out to him. To grow in our faith, then, we need to have Jesus in our hearts and in our mouths. There are times when we need to talk about our faith, and there are times when we just need to show our faith. There are times when I need to share, though, what Christ means to me and what he can mean to that person. You don't have to be eloquent. You just have to love the Lord and be willing to talk about what that means to you personally. God may not call you to be a great speaker, but he does call you to tell others about him. He calls us to let our light shine, and he calls us to have a heart for him and to have lips for him. That's what this passage says. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Lips and heart. We began today by talking about a young couple separated by his job. Have you ever been around somebody who is madly in love? Have you ever noticed how easily they talk about the person they're in love with? That's the natural inclination of somebody whose heart is full of devotion. That can be our natural inclination if our heart is full of devotion for our Savior. We need to strap on our good news shoes and follow Jesus wherever he takes us. As we follow him, we tread out, we live out, and we walk out the gospel of peace in palatable ways. There's an old, old story, and some of you may have heard it, about a cobbler, a godly man who made shoes in the old days. One night, the cobbler dreamed that the next day Jesus was going to come to visit him. The dream seemed so real that he got up very early the next morning and hurried to the woods, where he gathered green boughs to decorate his shop for the arrival of so great a guest. He waited all morning, but to his disappointment, his shop remained quiet, except for an old man who limped up to the door asking to come in for a few minutes of warmth. While the man was resting, the cobbler noticed that the old fellow's shoes were worn through. He was a cobbler after all. So the cobbler took a new pair from the shelves and saw to it that the stranger was wearing them as he went on his way. Throughout the afternoon, the cobbler waited and waited, but his only visitor was an elderly woman. He had seen her struggling under a heavy load of firewood, and he invited her, too, into his shop to rest. Then he discovered that for 2 days she had had nothing to eat. He saw to it that she had a nourishing meal, and then she went on her way. As night began to fall, the cobbler heard a child crying outside his door. The child was lost and afraid. The cobbler went out and soothed the youngster's tears, and with the little hand in his, took the child home. When he returned, the cobbler was really sad and down. He was convinced that while he had been away, he had missed the visit of his Lord. In his head, he lived through the moments as he imagined them, the knock on the door, the latch lifted, the radiant face, the offered cup. He would have kissed the hands where the nails had been, washed the feet where the spikes had entered. Then the Lord would have sat down and talked to him. In his anguish, the cobbler cried out, "Why is it, Lord, that your feet delay? Have you forgotten that this was your day? This was the day you were coming." Then, soft in the silence, he heard a voice say, "Lift up your heart, for I kept my word. 3 times I came to your friendly door. 3 times my shadow was on your floor. I was the man with the bruised feet. I was the woman who you gave food to eat. And I was the child who was homeless on the street." Just as in this tale of the cobbler, when we have Christ in our hearts, others will see Christ, even when we don't realize it. When we have Christ on our lips and tell others about what he has done for each of us, others will hear Christ talking, whether we realize that or not. For you and I, the time for silence is over. People in our world today are hungering for hope, and we need to introduce them to the one who is the source of all hope. We have shoes. We have shoes. We have good new shoes. The cobbler in the story I just shared with you woke up in the morning after his dream, ready to meet Christ. Instead, he met an old man that he shot, an old woman that he fed, and a young child that he helped find the way home. All just things like what you do in the day of a cobbler. It's what you do in the name of someone from Branches. Our Lord knows, though, that in meeting the needs of those three individuals, the cobbler himself, the shoemaker, met Christ. Jesus is to be found in serving others. We look into his eyes every time we look into the eyes of somebody in need. Each act of compassion, every gift of love, and every deed of kindness done in his name brings us closer to him, because it brings us closer to knowing the heart of God. We are walking with our good news shoes on our feet. The Christian life is about strapping on our sandals, picking up our walking stick, and following after Jesus. He is the Master of Mercy. Treading out the gospel in today's reading, Paul quotes the Old Testament when he says, "As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." The chief aim of God's church is to multiply disciples, not just so that people can find satisfaction and peace in Christ, but that's important. The chief aim of God's church is to multiply disciples, because as we do that, as we put our good news shoes on, we offer to everybody that we meet an opportunity to gather into a place worshiping Jesus as their creator. We offer them an opportunity to make a choice, to be saved or not to be saved. That's our link in the chain. We offer them an opportunity. Ephesians 6 refers to the good news shoes too. "Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace." The biblical command to go into all the world and make disciples is not simply for those who've been called to the mission field. We all have an opportunity. We all have an important part to play in spreading the gospel. The gospel isn't a story simply to be told, but to be lived out. We must ask ourselves every single morning when we strap on our sandals, our Nikes, our dress shoes, or whatever, am I wearing my good news shoes? Is my life a reflection of the gospel, of God's grace? Have I strapped on my sandals, picked up my walking stick, and am I following the Master of Mercy? Wherever we go, our mission is to reflect the love of Christ, to share the love of Christ, to leave footprints of Christ's love wherever we've been. The chief purpose of this life has very little to do with our comfort and everything to do with the glorification of God in Christ in us. The beautiful thing about our good news shoes is that not only do they help us to leave footprints of Christ's love wherever we journey, but they are also good news to us, to you and to me. They give us tremendous stability, a firm foundation in this life when we are so often standing on shaky ground. As you and I strap on our good news shoes, we follow Jesus Christ, our Lord, wherever he takes us. As we follow him, we tread out, we live out, and we walk out the gospel of peace in palpable ways. The gospel isn't an idea, it's a way of life. It's a way of life that influences every decision we make and every path we take. We find ourselves wearing shoes which give us great footing in spite of whatever comes our way. We don't always understand why the things in this life happen, Though we know and trust in a merciful God who is sovereign over his creation and our lives, Reinhold Messner was a skilled mountain climber who was recognized as the best in the world. He was one of two men who first climbed Mount Everest without using bottled oxygen. Messner then decided that doing it with a partner was not good enough, so he went back and did it alone. He was asked, as most mountain climbers are, why do you do it? What's the deal? He replied, because at the top, all the lines converge. Even though we may not always have the view from the top, it's a great encouragement to know that our Father does. He is sovereign. He has said, I am the Lord, I do not change. All the lines converge at the top. Because he sees the overall picture, he's worthy of our trust, even when we don't understand the why of this life. Even when we're not sure where the path is leading us, our only real job is to daily strap on those shoes so that we can reflect the love of God in Christ to this world and have the sure footing needed to traverse all the trails of our life. Our task is to take each step of faith, reflecting grace to the world around us, and leaning on that grace to sustain us.